Reading from Isaiah 52 and 53 this evening. See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. Just as there were many who were appalled at him, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any human being, and his form marred beyond human likeness. So he will sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For what they were not told, they will see. And for what they have not heard, they will understand. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. Let's sing together. Would you stand?
So I'll cherish. You may be seated.
Are there any songs that bring memories to your mind? That one really does for me. I remember an old country preacher singing that song like it was the first time he ever heard it, every time he ever sang it. And 61 years after he came to Christ, he was still singing that song like he meant it. A country preacher was my grandfather. So I'm sitting there singing that song, all I could do was picture him. The tears coming down his face. Remembering what God did for him on February 16, 1936. And he got to graduate July 30th, 1995. He got to see the Jesus that he'd been singing to. Tonight, I want us to have a prayer of confession. And I don't want you just to say a prayer of confession. See, I don't think you can just say prayers of confession. I think you need to pour out prayers of confession. I think that we need to get our minds in the right place. So I'm going to click it on here, and it's going to be on the screen, I think. Are they not working? Is it out here? Oh, there it is. Okay. I want us to I want us to say the prayer of confession, but I don't want to just say it. I want us to confess it. You know what confession means? Confession means to agree with. So it's what God has already said, and we are agreeing with it. That's what confession is. So let's get our hearts and minds in that place as we share together. Holy God, you alone are holy and righteous, blameless and merciful. You alone know the depths of our sin and brokenness. When we were content to walk the earth in our sinful pride and rebellion, you sent us your Son to breathe life into our death. We were content to be orphans, but you sent your Son to adopt us into your family. We were content to be scattered individuals, but you made us a people by crushing your Son instead of us. We were content to shout out, "Crucify him," but Christ whispered, "Father, forgive them." We were content to choose to set Barabbas free from his chains, but you chose to release us from the chains of sin. We confess that even after our adoption, we still often live as though we were dead. We often act as though we do not have a good father. We often forsake the family of brothers and sisters whom you have saved us into. Father, forgive us when we follow in the footsteps of our enemy and seek to place ourselves above your throne. We plead that your Spirit would guide us and direct us towards humility and servant hearts, seeking to do your will above our own, just as Christ does. As we focus on the agony suffered by Christ on this Good Friday, let us look forward to Resurrection Sunday, when death itself reaps what it has sown. Until then, may we lament and mourn over our sin, knowing that the price demanded for reconciliation has been paid for by your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank and praise you, Almighty God. In Jesus we pray. Amen. If you would, it's in your bulletin, but will also be up on the screen as well. I want us to share in a time of responsive reading. With a kiss of betrayal, Judas believed he was instigating the liberation of Israel. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Through that kiss, Judas made a way for the liberation of all people. See, I am making all things new. With the charge of blasphemy, the elders believed that they were protecting their religion. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Through that charge, Jesus showed that true faith is about relationship with God and not human structures. See, I am making all things new. With a sentence of death, the Roman Empire believed they were preserving power through violence. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Through that death sentence, Jesus revealed violence to be no match for sacrifice. See, I am making all things new. With obedience to duty, the soldiers believed they were bringing order and peace to the world by way of a political kingdom. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Through that obedience, Jesus brought order and peace to the world by way of a heavenly kingdom. See, I am making all things new. With jeers of insult, observers at Calvary believed they were undermining the identity and purpose of Jesus. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. In spite of those jeers, Jesus demonstrated that true identity and purpose are defined by God alone. See, I am making all things new. With a shout of triumph, the accuser believed he was seeing his hold of the world solidified. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Through that shout, Jesus showed that the arrogance of the evil one was blinding. See, I am making all things new. With 3 days of mourning, Jesus' followers believed they were closing this chapter of their lives. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Through those 3 days, Jesus accomplished not an end, but a beginning. See, I am making all things new.
Jesus and had him flogged.
The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again and again, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they slapped him in the face. And once more, Pilate came out and said to the Jews gathered there, "Look, I'm bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis or charge against him." And when Jesus came out wearing a crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." As soon as the chief priest and their officials saw him, they shouted, "Crucify! Crucify!" But Pilate answered, "You take him and crucify him. As for me, I find no basis for a charge against him." The Jewish leaders insisted, "We have a law, and according to that law, he must die because he claimed to be the Son of God." When Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid, and he went back inside the palace. "Where do you come from?" he asked Jesus, but Jesus gave him no answer. "Do you refuse to speak to me?" Pilate said. "Don't you realize I have power either to free you or to crucify you?" And Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to set Jesus free, but the Jewish leaders kept shouting, "If you let this man go, you are no friend to Caesar. Anyone who claims to be king opposes Caesar." And when Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out and set him down on the judge's seat at the palace known as the Stone Pavement, which in Aramaic is Gabbatha. It was the day of preparation of the Passover, and it was about noon. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews. But they shouted, "Take him away! Take him away! Crucify him!" "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priest answered. And finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified.
The cross is a symbol. Some think of it as a logo. For some, it's just a piece of jewelry. It's worn from clergy to rock stars and everyone in between. At its core, what does it mean? What does it mean to you? The cross is empty, but has not always been that way. We rightly want to celebrate Easter and an empty tomb. I'm with you. I want to get there. And we often hear statements like, "It's Friday, but Sunday's coming." But you will not, indeed, cannot have resurrection without a death. You and I cannot have resurrection without a death. And that's what this night is for. It's to witness to a death. It's to remember, to repent, to remind ourselves and others what the author of love did for us. I don't want us to walk away too quickly. I don't want us to run away too quickly. I want us to stop and wait upon the Lord. I want us to remember that he who knew no sin became sin for us. It had all been leading up to this as he entered the garden with those who promised that no matter what happens, we're with you. No matter what comes our way, we're with you. see him walk away from the group for the last time to be an intimate moments with his father. See such pressure and stress that the capillaries underneath his skin began to burst and his sweat was no longer clear. His sweat was as great drops of blood. I want you to go with me to the religious halls where the leaders were holding court. They were trying to find some false witnesses who could string together a story good enough to hold water. They were having a hard time. I want you to go back across town to a weak governor that wanted just to keep the peace. And still others got involved. A symbolic king named Herod said, "I've been waiting to see Jesus." He wanted him to do some tricks for him. "Show me some stuff," he said. And watch as that small band of disciples who had their courage evaporate that very night. The one that's closest to him before the night was over would say these words, "I don't even know him." A betrayal and a denial was about all that was left from the group that promised to follow him no matter what. There was one last chance. There was a custom that was every Passover. There was a custom that they had that they would release a prisoner. They would release one to them. And so they brought up Barabbas. If there was ever a sure thing, it's Jesus getting released. Right? You had Barabbas, this nasty, hostile, grungy, filthy criminal, career criminal, that the government was just waiting to put to death on the cross. And then you had Jesus. And what had Jesus done? Nothing but when healed, nothing but set people free, nothing but gave life to people, nothing but showed kindness, nothing but healed, nothing but did what was right. Surely this was an easy choice, was it not? You had Barabbas over here and you had Jesus over here. And yet we know exactly what happened. Barabbas was the one released and they yelled to crucify Christ. I can't imagine what Barabbas must have been thinking as he hurried out of custody. I bet he ran for the city gate, thinking any moment they're going to change their mind. How could they not? But they didn't. The one that only showed love and kindness was the one that was handed over to the professional killers. Even in a culture that's increasingly violent, even in one that we're no longer shocked by almost anything, I was shocked as I read about the crucifixion again this year. As I read about what Christ went through for us, there is a Dr. Schreier that's an associate professor of chemistry and biology at Azusa Pacific, and every year she does a retelling of the crucifixion that is one of the most popular things on campus. And people come to hear her talk about what happened to Christ that night of crucifixion. And she talks about that rare condition when there's so much stress and so much pressure upon a person. It's very, very rare indeed. Hemiohidrosis. And that's whenever the capillaries begin to break and burst. And it says in Matthew 26 that Jesus was grieved to the point of death. So much so that his sweat was as blood pouring out of his body. Traveling from Pilate to Herod and back again, Jesus easily walked 2.5 miles through a night that would see no rest at all. He had not slept. He was under such duress that he was sweating blood. He was walking back and forth between Herod and Pilate. The whip that they used had strips of leather. In the middle of the strips were metal balls that hit the skin, causing deep bruising. In addition, sheep bone was attached to the tips of each strip. So difficult and so horrendous was Roman flogging that they made a law that you could not give more than 39. And the reason they did that is because very, very few people survived 39. That's exactly how many Jesus was administered. When the bone makes contact with Jesus' skin, it digs into the muscle, tearing out chunks of flesh and exposing the bone up beneath. The flogging leaves the skin on Jesus' back in long ribbons. By this point, he has lost a great volume of blood, which causes his blood pressure to fall and puts him into shock. The human body attempts to remedy those imbalances by decreasing the blood volume. So Jesus' thirst and his body's natural response was his body's natural response to his suffering. So if he would have drank water, his blood volume would have increased. Instead, the Roman soldiers placed a crown of thorns on Jesus' head and a robe on his back. Listen, the robe helps the blood clot to keep the misery going, to keep it going longer, to prevent Jesus from sustaining more blood loss. As they hit Jesus in the head, the thorns from the crown push deeper into his skin. He begins bleeding profusely. The thorns also cause damage to the nerve that supplies the face, causing intense pain in his face and in his neck. As they mock him, the soldiers also belittle Jesus by spitting on him. They rip the robe off Jesus' back, and the bleeding starts. Jesus' physical condition becomes critical. Due to severe blood loss without replacement, Jesus is undoubtedly in shock. As such, he is unable to carry the cross, and Simon of Cyrene is drafted to do it. Possibly the most painful death ever invented by humankind. The English language derives the word excruciating from our word crucifixion. Acknowledging as a form of slow, painful suffering, its punishment was reserved only for slaves, foreigners, revolutionaries, and violent criminals. Jesus is thrown to the ground, reopening his wounds, grinding in dirt and causing bleeding. They nail his hands to the cross, huge nails, 7 to 9 inches, that damage and sever the major nerves to the hand upon impact, that causes continuous agonizing pain in both of Jesus' arms. As he is lifted, Jesus' full weight pulls down on the nailed wrist, and his shoulders and elbows are dislocated. In the position, Jesus' arms stretch to a minimum of 6 inches longer than they originally were. As Jesus hangs on the cross, the weight of his body pulls down on the diaphragm, and the air moves into his lungs and remains there. Jesus must push up on his nailed feet to exhale. In order to speak, air must pass over the vocal cords during exhalation. The Gospels note that Jesus spoke 7 times from the cross. It is amazing, despite his pain, he pushes up to say, "Forgive me." The difficulty surrounding his breathing slows as he slowly begins to suffocate. The body responds instinctively by triggering a desire to breathe. At the same time, the heart beats faster to create oxygen. The decreased oxygen causes damage to the tissues, and it causes leaking watery fluid from the blood into the tissues. This results in a buildup of fluid around the heart and lungs, and the collapsing lungs, the failing heart, the dehydration, and the inability to get sufficient oxygen to the tissues essentially suffocates the victim. The decreased oxygen also damages the heart, which leads to cardiac arrest. Jesus most likely died from a heart attack. Jesus felt every ounce of his execution. Every ounce. What greater love has any man than this? That he would lay down his life for his friends. And where were his friends? They weren't at the cross. Those were only the mockers. Those were the people that were spitting and ridiculing him, saying, "Come down. If you're really the Son of God, come down." The old Isaac Watts song, "See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did e'er such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown?" Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were a present far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my all. We can say, thank you, Lord, for your amazing love and mercy. We can commit ourselves to him and his never-failing love. We can come and give ourselves afresh to him. We can come and experience again the power of his death, experience again the power of what it meant for Christ to give himself. Remember again the cost that he gave for us. As I read that this week, I was just again gripped by what Christ has done for us. I was again gripped by what Jesus has done for us, that he gave himself for us. I would have written me off. Anyone with me? In a moment. And yet Christ gave himself for us. As I read through that, as I read the suffering that he experienced, as I read the pain that he endured, I was reminded again. Because I want to run. I can't wait to get to Sunday. I am going to jump up and down on Sunday. I am going to rejoice on Sunday. I'm going to shout it loud. I am going to wake up. I'm not even a morning person, but on Easter Sunday, I wake up with a smile on my face. I can't wait to get to worship. I can't wait to do those things. But you know what? This time has become one of the most meaningful times in my faith because I want to remember what Christ has done. I want to get myself back in that place of humility. I want to get myself into that place. I want to get myself low again. So I begin to look up at the cross. I want to get myself in a position again so that I will again remember what Christ did for me. I never want the cross to become clean. It's bloody. It's broken. It's cruel. I don't ever want to forget that. I want to live in that. Paul said these words, "I know nothing among you except for Christ crucified." I know nothing among you except for Christ crucified. His crucifixion, his death, his suffering for me is what I live in so that in his life I may know true life. In his life I may know the truth. I may walk in it. Tonight I want us to take some moments. I don't want to rush by. So oftentimes it's easy, isn't it? And we just want to get to the good stuff. But I want to remember that. I want the old rugged cross to move me. I want that to move me. I want to think about what Christ did for me, and I want it to grab my soul. I want it to completely hold me as I remember what Christ has done. I don't want to go by Friday to get to Sunday too quick. Because only in that will we know real life. Only in that will we know true life. I want to get to the resurrection, but we got to get here first. We got to go here first. And that's why Good Friday has become one of the most meaningful days in my life. The most meaningful time in my life. And I hope it will be for you. Father, I pray tonight, Lord, I pray. We've taken just a few moments tonight, Lord, not very long. We've taken just some moments, Lord, to reflect. Lord, it's not one of those exciting things. It's not one of those things where we want to shout hallelujah. But Lord, there
there is a moment, there's some time that we need to silence ourselves, that we need to humble ourselves, that we need to go back to the cross. We need to go to the cross. We need to get ourselves low before that cross. We need to look up at a Savior who's marred and broken, whose flesh is torn, whose hands are ripped, whose side is pierced, whose brow is pressed with thorns. We need to go back there. We need to go back. We need to remember what you've done for us. We need to remember what you've done for us, Lord. We need to remember that. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you could have just said no. In the garden, you could have said no. You could have ran out of there. You could have left. On the cross, you could have called for a legion of angels. You could have done any of those things. It says Caiaphas and the others laughed and mocked and spit and jeered. He said, Father, forgive me. You stayed on the cross because you needed to say, it is finished. Because if you don't say that, Lord, I don't have a chance, and no one in this room has a chance. We're all lost. Unless you say, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Salvation will not happen. There is no forgiveness. There is no hope. There is no life. Help us to remember that. Help us to live in that. Jesus, we need you. We need you tonight, Lord. We need not to rush by. We need to sit at the cross. We need to kneel at the cross. We need to lay at the cross. In the blood.
And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they cast lots to divide his garments. And he said to him, truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? This is my God, why have you forsaken me? After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scriptures, I thirst. A jar full of sour wine stood there. So they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And having said this, he breathed his last.
Indeed, we were there, weren't we? The heart of God. As we leave tonight, I'm going to ask you to do a couple things. I'm going to ask you, as I'm going to close in prayer, I'm going to ask you just to stay seated for a moment. I'm going to carry the cross out. I'm going to ask you to wait until the cross is out into the hallway before you leave. I'm going to ask you to stay silent from the time you leave until you get to your car, just as a time of final reflection about this night. Father, we love you. We thank you. Lord, we thank you for your gift of life. And we know the gift of life meant your death. From the very beginning, Lord, from the very beginning of your ministry, that's what you began to say. You began to say, the Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. He's going to be crucified. He's going to be crucified. In the very beginning, Lord, you knew before the foundation of the earth, it says, you were slain. Before a single thing was created, you knew you would have to give yourself. And you said yes. For some reason, you believed that we were worthy. Lord, we pray that as we leave tonight, I pray every one of us in this room, Lord, will find just at least a few more minutes to just settle our hearts on the gift that you've given us. That, Lord, we won't rush to whatever we're heading to next without just taking some time, just remembering, putting ourselves there, Lord. What a gift. The Lord of life, God of creation, the King of kings, and the Lord of lords being beaten like a criminal. Being hung upon a cross, just like the thieves beside him. There's no way to fully understand that. There's no way to fully grasp what you've done. But Lord, I pray that we take some moments and that we remember. Thank you.